Ladies and gentlemen, King Win Pro League 2015. We're on week 9. We just had a match, Colento versus Orange. That was a really impressive series of games. We had a 2-0 lead from Orange over Colento, and Colento reverse sweeped his opponent with a lineup that we thought at first would have a really tough time.
Yeah, it was the lineup of especially just Priest would have a really hard time against Rogue, but unfortunately, Orange kind of brought more of a minion-based rogue that was somewhat more vulnerable to just the priest deck, basically because of the thought steals, because of cabals, because of shadow madness. There's just so many ways for the priest to interact with the rogue deck. Whereas normally, if it's more of a combo-based rogue, there's fewer ways to interact with it.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense. I think that's a better matchup for him. So he's got to have been happy about the fact that, you know, he's the Hungry Dragons, which already indicates that there's going to be minions on the board as opposed to just trying to hoard spells to go for a huge unleash of damage. So that was a pretty good matchup for Colento. Now, Kaldi versus Amaz is going to be coming up next. I just want to point out this is the last day of the pre-playoff. So today is the last day of qualifiers for the semifinals, quarterfinals that are going to be coming up on May 8th, so we're still, you know, a week and a half away from that, but that's going to be the big event. And right now, Kaldi is in the top three of Group Horde, so he's trying this. I think he's going to be able to stay in the top three no matter what happens here. Although Colento did win a game, so if Kaldi loses, there's a possibility that Colento is able to take up an additional match here. Like if he's 6-3 and Kaldi loses 5-4, then Colento could go up and Kaldi go down out of the top three.
Pretty much anyone's game at this moment. And this upcoming matchup, Kaldi versus Amaz, I feel like it's really a matchup between two players that are on very different, very opposite ends of the spectrum. First of all, we have Amaz, who is pretty much the most known Hearthstone player in the world. His stream is the biggest, and he's been playing in so many tournaments. He gets invited to everything, but at the same time, he's very busy. He has to run a team, he has to stream, and he just doesn't have as much time to prepare for Kingwin. On the other hand, we have Kaldi. He's not as well known. He doesn't get as many invites. And this is pretty much the thing that he has going for him. He has enough time to just prepare for this nonstop. And it really shows in each player's results. Kaldi is doing so well in this league, whereas Amaz, because he doesn't have as much time to prepare for the league, he isn't doing nearly as well. Pretty much Kaldi going 5-3 so far, Amaz going 3-5. So exactly on opposite ends of the spectrum.
Yeah, and you know, Amaz got a lot of stuff going on at the moment, and he's got even the tournament that he's organizing, I think this week on Thursday. There is the BlackRock Team Brawl 2v2 tag team. You said it was a reminder of the old ESGN times, where basically, I remember those days pretty fondly, because it was like the beginning, the budding Hearthstone scene on a competitive level. That was really interesting, and now Amaz is bringing back the team-based card game, so you'll see 2v2 happen on Amaz's channel with the BlackRock tournament. So Kaldi versus Amaz, do you think, like, I know Amaz has improved a lot in the last year, well, in the last, you know, half year, even the last 6 months, he's done a lot better than he initially did. He used to play exclusively Priest almost, which was enough for the longest time, but now with the metagame and how diverse it is, he's definitely diversified his portfolio.
Ooh, technical terms. Well, you know, Amaz, pretty much all the pro players say that Amaz has improved so much over the past year, but it's kind of funny in that he's done much worse in terms of results over the past year. It's just how funny.
Ragnaros, man. Ragnaros. Yeah.
His Ragnaros shots haven't been as good. That's just what it comes down to, really, right?
Yeah, that's
to the
pretty
point,
much it.
Enough to the point that he just took it out of somebody's decks. If not all.
He finally realized, like, everyone else's experience with Rag. Because for all that time, he just stole everyone's RNG. But now it's back to normal. And he's like, you know what? This card doesn't even... What am I doing with this? And, yeah, I guess variance will hit you. I mean, Rhinos is not an auto-include anyway in every single deck.
Yeah, we do have the lineups for both players. We have Kaldi running Hunter, Paladin, Warlock, Druid... Hunter, Paladin, Warlock, and Amaz running Druid, Warrior, and Warlock. Now, I have to pay attention to this one specific class, Warrior. And Amaz, even though he's known as a Priest player, recently he's really been enjoying Warrior in his lineups. Another player that enjoys Warrior a lot is Trump. And yet another player that runs Warrior in a lot of his lineups is Masan. Now, what do all three of these players have in common?
I don't want to answer that.
It's that they're all really huge streamers, right, Masan?
Okay.
Yes.
I was going to say they're all Monk, but no, I was wrong. Never mind. Oh, God. So I just wonder, though, like, Kaldi brought Paladin. Okay, it's a class that's pretty strong right now. It hasn't changed, though, with BRM, or has it? I haven't seen anything different about the way they played before Blackrock Mountain came out and after. I thought Dragon Consort would spice up things a little bit, but that doesn't seem to be the case.
Yeah, I think we're going to have to wait a bit until like all the new Dragon cards come out. And this Paladin that Kaldi is running, it's probably going to be like a standard mid-range Paladin.
Okay, there's really little else that you're about to see. What I wonder, though, is Amaz is very, proficient with combo plays, right? Like the Wild Pyromancer plays that he's known for, he does them pretty well. He's very experienced with that. Is he going to bring Grim Patron Warrior, or would he prefer just a standard Control Warrior? Because you mentioned, you know, he's been playing quite a bit of it.
To be honest, I don't think Amaz is the kind of player to bring Grim Patron Warrior to tournaments. Back in the day when Miracle Rogue was just super popular, Amaz never learned the deck, and I feel like Grim Patron Warrior, it's kind of close to Rogue, right? Miracle Rogue, that there's just so many combos, so much potential for you to draw so many cards in one single turn. So I have to feel like Amaz, he's going to be sticking to the more tried and true Warrior if I had to take a guess.
All right, it makes a little bit of sense. A comfort pick out of the two archetypes. Both of them were represented equally, I think, in C-Story, 7-7. And I don't remember exactly, but there was a graphical rendering of that was made. And I think Grim Patron did overall slightly better in general, but combo decks are also better against slower decks, so sometimes you can pull off amazing wins in a slower metagame.
I believe that graphic was referring to DreamHack Bucharest.
All right, DreamHack, not C-Story Cup. That's right. I'm completely...
They had one for C-Story Cup as well, and then right. at C-Story Cup, when I saw it, it was 7-7 Warriors. I think he's talking about
C-Story Cup. Well, no, at C-Story Cup, the only player to bring Patron Warrior was Frodan.
Frodan, yeah.
Yeah, the only player. I guess Frodan is just ahead of the metagame.
Yeah, legendary. That's what it is. He became legendary.
He is on Tempo Storm,
after joining,
right?
Tempo Storm.
Of course. He's the manager. Who's more legendary now? Oh wait, is he the manager or the PR guy? Like, officially, Reyna the manager, or is that Frodan?
Frodan is the manager. That's Reyna managed all the times on the stream as well.
All right, got it. So I just want to know, like, this lineup here. We saw the first game is gonna be Kaldi's playing Paladin versus Amaz's Warrior. Usually, I think this is a matchup that favors the Paladin. At least he used to pretty heavily. Things might have changed a bit with the Shield mini bot. Makes it even stronger, I feel. And Muster for Battle adds on top of the pain. But if Amaz is playing enough Whirlwinds, that could be a decisive factor in that matchup. And I haven't seen any Revenge being played in Warrior.
I actually disagree with that to a certain extent. I know a lot of people will say, oh my god, Warriors is so disfavored against Paladin. But there are deck types, or you can design a Warrior deck so that it actually counters Paladin with a double Brawl and Ysera. And a lot of people have been playing Alexstrasza for Ysera recently, so it's more reason to do it, right?
All right, so that actually makes quite a bit of sense. Do you think Amaz is going to be running that type of decked out Warrior to counter a possible Paladin from Kaldi? Or how does that do against Zoo? Because that's the biggest question. If it happens to do well against Pally, the question is, how well does that Warrior deck that you tech for Paladin do against Zoo in general?
Well, I think I those deck choices... With... Yeah, go ahead, Masan.
I would say with the introduction of the Imp Gang boss, the Zoo is still favorite against Warrior, but it all depends on Fire Even X, right?
Yeah. We do see, though, some Warriors tech in that double Brawl, especially for that Zoo matchup. And in fact, Fibonacci, which is one of the most common or most popular NA ladder warriors, warrior in two different respects, he's been teching in double Brawl into his decks. Also, Ysera has been, I feel like Amaz, is the type of player to run Ysera in his decks.
Most definitely.
Yeah, maybe not for the Paladin matchup, but just in general.
All right, going into the game here, we see a
Chilwin Yeti.
That's good, actually. Or is it? It's pretty good. It's not better than a Shredder, though. I think he... Is that for against, like, a possible Priest from Amaz? Is that why he built his Paladin that way?
I mean, it's certainly possible, though. Amaz hasn't been running Priest in a very long time. Basically, right. The last time he ran it was at Gfinity, which was just where he got extremely punished for it. He basically lost... He went 0-6 with his Priest, essentially, in that tournament. He actually would have won if he brought pretty much any other deck, because he won all his matches with his other decks that he brought to the tournament. But just Priest, it couldn't take a game off of anything, because he ran into an opponent that basically he ran Handlock, Warrior, and Druid, which are some pretty fairly unfavorable matchups. Or rather, Rogue, Handlock, and Warrior.
Okay. You remember all those lineups by heart. You have, like, a perfect memory. It's pretty impressive. So, I want to bring attention to what happened last turn, where Kaldi decided to play a 1-1 to feed into the Armorsmith. I think what he was trying to do is, well, I don't have Coin True Silver, so you can play your Acolyte of Pain on turn 3. Yeah. And I won't be able to take it, which is kind of a bit of a bluff, and I think it was really well executed. If that was the intent, of course.
Yeah, I think what I've heard from some Warrior players, the logic behind that is, like, basically, the Warrior is going to get infinite armor anyway. You can't really stop it. So it doesn't really matter too much how much armor you give him. It's rather that the Armorsmith health is more valuable to you.
All right, so getting in Consecration range as soon as possible may be more impactful.
Yeah, perhaps. Or if you draw something into something like a Shielded Mini-Bot, that might be impactful as well.
All right. Well, this Death
Bite.
That's
really risky, by the way. Just weapon up and just pass.
Well, yeah, what else would you... I guess you would play Cruel Task and... Because, I mean, he's playing into a possible weapon removal. Like, next turn, if anything, but...
Yeah, Amaz is going to get slightly punished for not just attacking with the Death Spite. But I think this is kind of like a metagame call. If Chilwin Yetis were really in the metagame, I think he would have attacked the previous turn. But really, typically, it's the 4-drop of the Pilot Shredder that's the most common these days, and Amaz was playing around that, basically, the Pilot Shredder.
I think that's a really nice call, because usually that would have been the perfect play against Pilot Shredder. Now, this Coghammer is... I'm going to take a wild guess and say it's going to get played. That would be my assumption in a position like this one.
You could also give a Knife Trickler and nope.
So trade... I don't know. That's a bit risky, isn't it? Although you could have gone for the Aldor Peacekeeper play, right?
Yeah. The Nitro Glare and that would have Aldor been Peacekeeper. It would be a pretty strong play as well.
Yeah. Well, Amaz has a board clear with the Cruel Taskmaster, so that's pretty good for him.
Yep, and he also has a Pile Shredder, which is perfect six and a total.
Wow, that is a really big pain, though, for Kaldi, because he's got no way to handle the 4-3. He's got a Coghammer that hits for only 2. So...
I think he'll have Taskmaster.
Whoa.
It's still somewhat okay for him. I guess you can play the Aldor here, just to get some tempo back. And I have to mention, that Chilwin Yeti, I think that's actually because he's running that card because he just wants more 4-drops in his hand. Or in his deck. Rather, the 4-drop place in... matchups, or rather the 4-drop slot in decks these days, I feel like, is the most important slot. It's the kind of the powered slot, so you just want to guarantee that you have a 4-drop. So I would actually expect to see a lot of even 2 Piloted Shredders in this deck in addition to the Chilwin Yetis.
Alright, well, it used to be the case that I think 6-drop were contested for with Cairn, Sylvanas, and Sunwalker, even back in the days. Now that's pretty much, you know, that everything is down to the 4-drops at this point. And this Emperor Thorsten is going to allow Amaz to get a really surprising Grom Hellscream, possibly. I mean, he's setting up for later. That's definitely going to pay off at some point. Wow. So Armor Up Shield Slam on Grom would actually enable it. That alone might be enough.
And the Paladin itself is low enough that you probably want that. I mean, I usually use Thors just so that I can Sylvanas and Brawl on as a Paladin, to be honest. But, man, that's going to be a surprise factor.
I don't think Kaldi should trade here into the his Aldor into the Pilot Shredder, because if he trades, he doesn't have a guaranteed way to kill this Emperor, which... I would have to think he wants off the board right now.
Yeah, definitely. Unless you consecrate, then it's not a trade. And he is going for it.
I like the consecrate play.
Ooh, I don't like the fact
doing
that
it
he...
first. I don't like doing it first, yeah, to be honest. But it'll pay off, I guess, in the end. It's a bit odd. Wait, what?
Wait a minute. What? Oh, he missed. There's
Wait,
no way.
Is what? He playing on his phone? What? Oh, there's been
strange.
A bit of lag on Hearthstone servers recently, but could that be it? Wait, yeah,
no. Then you can't play fast enough.
Yeah. What? That's.
Wait, was that lethal?
No, it wasn't. No, it was one
it
man
was
off.
Lethal.
Yeah, exactly. He didn't have armor at that point.
Wow.
That was confusing.
That might just be the, like, it's almost game
that's
ending.
That's the game,
which...
I think. Yeah.
Yeah,
that's
the game. There's no way.
Like, there's no way he comes back from double Emperor on 10 health against... I wonder what happened. Is Kaldi disconnected, perhaps?
Yeah, you know, Kaldi...
He was making moves until that point, though.
Yeah. Whenever I talk to him, he complains about the internet in Iceland, because that's where he lives right now. It's kind of like on a remote island, so it's one of the reasons, like, you don't see his camera right now, and one of the reasons, like, he might have some lag issues.
Well, Amaz is going to grab that lethal... Very easy one to spot. And he's gonna go for the Grom, and Kaldi's gonna fall down, so the Paladin will lose to Warrior. How favored would Kaldi have been if it had been a different outcome? If he'd actually been able to kill the Emperor.
I mean, that Emperor did like 10 damage, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think he would be quite favored. Typically, the Paladin is a good matchup for the Warrior, even though there was Brawl in Amaz's hand. If Kaldi were able to stabilize and then use have a turn where he can freely use his Lay on Hands, I think it would have been very good for Kaldi.
Yeah, I'm a little. It feels a little bad when games end like these and you don't get the actual ending that would have happened if all the plays were made. But that's a side effect of playing, you know, with a clock on. Hearthstone has a clock for those specific reasons to accelerate the turns. A little unfortunate. So Kaldi still has his Paladin though. At the very least, he's going to be able to reuse it. And Amaz's Warrior is now locked out, so he's going to have to go for Druid or Warlock on the back of this. Do you think Kaldi sticks to Paladin, or?
I think Paladin is. Decent matchup against Druid and a decent matchup against Warlock, any type of Warlock, to be honest, especially if it's Handlock, although I will say it's almost certain that Amaz is going to be playing the Zoo deck. Amaz is pretty well known for Zoo these days, and even back in the day when he was really dominating tournaments.
All right, well, that makes a lot of sense. And the good thing for Paladin in that specific matchup is the fact that between Consecrations, Coghammer, Two Server Champion, and the Shielded Minibots, they've got a really good way to answer the board, a lot better than it used to be. Paladin, in fact, was known for struggling against the early Zoo openers unless they had the perfect board wipe on turn 4. So that's gotten a bit better with time. I wonder if this will pay off in this specific case.
But with like Shielded Minibots, with Coghammer, with Monster for Battle, yeah, like you said, it's just going to get a lot better.
So Kaldi is going to be sticking to his Paladin, and Amaz is going to be moving on to Warlock, so we'll see if it's a Zoo deck or a Midrange or Handlock. I mean, there's like 18 archetypes for the deck right now, for the class rather, at this point. Midrange Warlock got streamlined quite a bit, though. I have to say, like, you remember the phase where we had about 17 types of midrange Warlock around? Now I think it's mostly demon-oriented. Most of them are, at the very least.
Mostly zoo-based demon-oriented, especially. It's been doing very, very well on ladder.
Yep. Oh, we'll see if that's what Amaz brought. You said he's known for that, then I trust your judgment. So Paladin versus the Warlock from Amaz. I'd have to say Aldor for tempo is also not even bad in that matchup. The opponent needs to have stuff like an Abusive Sergeant to make good trades.
Yeah. It's although I will say that if you Aldor early on, because these zoos are getting more mid-rangey or more higher curving, if you Aldor early on, you might not be able to Aldor something like a Void Terror, something like a Dr. Boom, or something like a Doom Guard, and that can just be devastating.
Yeah, I'm happy for the return of Void Terror, though.
It's certainly a card that's not run in 100% of Demon Lock decks or just Zoo decks.
Yeah. We've seen a lot
that's
of
interesting
this.
Interesting hand. Oh, he's going to keep it. It makes sense, though. It had it in curve.
Job's done. Well met.
I mean, this is kind of an average hand for Kaldi.
And
he has
very,
the owl.
Very good hand for a Zoo player, I think.
The owl is very good. Knife Juggler could have been good, and I think it's going to be good in this situation because Amaz doesn't have an Abusive Sergeant, and also Muster for Battle is always going to be good.
Mal'Ganis is a bit early, a bit too early with the Doomguard set up in hand right now. That can almost prevent you from playing the Doomguard altogether.
Yeah, it's just one of the unfortunate aspects about running this mid-range Zoo. It's that you can get these cards stuck in your hand, like Doomguard plus the Dr. Boom, or Doomguard plus the Mal'Ganis, and it's just really hard to play the Doomguard on curve or just straight up from your hand. And that's where the Void Callers come in.
Oh my god, I just realized.
What is it?
You just attack here and then just go for a Cockhammer.
Yeah, you want to attack first, I think. A lot of people, you know, I've talked, there's a huge question of when do you Cockhammer, before or after, and I think in this specific case, there's a much better outcome if you attack first, just because he's going to have to go through two attacks, obviously, to get everything done.
Yeah, yep. I think most players, what they would do here is Iron Beak, Owl Beak, Egg, because it just feels so good. But I like your play better, Masan. Just like Cogcamming here, because even if your opponent Power Overwhelmings, or something like Abusive Sergeants, he doesn't kill anything.
Oh, no.
Yeah, he'll be able to... yeah, exactly. He'll be able to basically clear it off the next turn with the Divine Shield Knife Juggler.
I was going to say, it also prevents Maz from going for Coin Implosion. Yeah. In this case... Oh...
Well, we'll see what ends up happening down the line. Maybe Kaldi was trying to play around a possible Void Terror that would have forced him to get a really good juggle to wipe the 4-4, but...
It actually... No, it plays into it. It doesn't play around... I'm sorry. It still kills off the Void Terror play, because you just go for... You just kill off the Void Terror with your knife alone, because you have an Iron Big Owl. Well, I guess you don't really... You can't really kill the 4-4 in that case. Unless
exactly. Like, that's about it.
Good knife hits.
Bane of Doom, my favorite card in the game right now.
Yeah, I love it so much because it doesn't feel like, unlike Implosion Swings that were really obscene initially when the card was released, it seems to have reduced, like the variance of it seems to be less aggravating nowadays. Bane of Doom is still on the super funky end of RNG. It can either be completely amazing or a complete whiff, but on average, it's still great.
Amazing turn 5, by the way, coming from Kaldi.
Yeah, Dive didn't mention it, but yeah. Wow. Unleash the Hounds. Yep. Unleash the dudes.
Well, not quite as good as Unleash the Hounds, but I think Kaldi will take it.
Oh, wow. Double Bane of Doom here for Amaz.
Whoa. That's actually surprising.
I'll take that.
Surprising.
Yeah, most players just play one. Aw, that's unfortunate. Most players just play one Bane of Doom, but Amaz is kind of like the player that goes for those RNG cards, and he's known for playing Ragnarose, playing like Unstable Portal, playing Bane of Doom.
Well, if Kaldi uses a Yeti, it's going to give Amaz another good Bane of Doom.
Unless the Divine Shield comes down to Yeti. I think I'll just go for Cockhammer first.
Yeah.
Do what the Divine Shield gets. If Yeti gets a Divine Shield, then it's just great, right?
I think you just attack with a 1-1 and your Cogghammer anyway, so you keep the Yeti up at 4.
Oh.
No.
RNG Stone. Wow. Okay. Well, that'll do it. That's going to be really hard for Amaz to recover from.
Well, maybe we can see a second Bane of Doom here.
I think we will.
Yes.
And it better be a Jiraxxus, because I'm quitting the game if it's not.
Mal'Ganis!
Oh no.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
That's very unfortunate.
Yeah, that's like...
It's unfortunate, but at least Kaldi won't be able to develop anything this turn. I think the play here is just, honestly, just the hero power.
I hope he doesn't get to use a Game Hunter. Sometimes you just want to play it against the Zoo. Especially against two Bane of Dooms.
Yeah, but the Zoo's been, like, the plays that Zoo have made so far have been so slow this game that I think you have to suspect there's some, you know, top end cards. And Sea Giant is now pretty popular, at least as a one of in those decks. You have to keep BGH.
Yeah, I would definitely not play a BGH here. Like, because your opponent's hand looks so clunky, I would actually, if I were Kaldi, I'd be like, okay, he definitely has Dr. Boom here or something.
And Amaz just keeps getting. Weird card. So I think the play here is to play Juggler, then eat them both.
Really? Really?
That seems, that seems like a great play to me.
Oh my god.
Is it going to be a double juggle, one Void Terror to eat a juggler? It might just be. Yeah. He eats only one.
It's 6 and 5, so...
Well, he plays around BGH here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Shield tap. Red alert. So do you have two equality cons? Like, you've seen two jugglers, so which one damage cards are Moz going to pull out? Like, Mortal Coil has been cut out. A lot of decks have cut out the obligatory Mortal Coils. Not every deck has. But if you're not expecting too much face hunter from your opponent,
I don't think you have to go as far as equality consecrate, but no. I would definitely consider using one of them.
One consecration, maybe shielded mini bot on the back end.
Yeah.
What if you just lay on hands yourself and kill the juggler with the weapon?
If you have to use either one of them, why would you use it? Because you can just put the knife juggler easily.
Yeah, with your weapon, that's the thing. I think you maybe lay on hands straight up and kill the juggler with your face. Or is that... Because you have the equality concept in case things get out of hand, right?
Yeah, and then you can also just... Uh-oh.
Galdi disagrees. All right.
I think this is fine, too, actually, because now he's putting pressure on his opponent.
The Warlock is very low in health, and you have 7, 8, 9 damage on board.
Oh, wow. He finds the Void Caller with Defend of Argus. That's as good as it could have possibly gotten in a situation like this one. He, no matter what, he's getting his two demons out next turn.
Yep.
Pretty much. Like, there's no way he's not. And the problem is, if Mal'Gens comes out now, Galdi gets a free ticket.
Yep.
Wow.
Oh, no, it's not.
That is not... Well, then again, I don't think that's that bad of a situation either way.
So, Void Caller just summoned a 7-9.
Yep. Sounds fair.
Sounds so fair. It's 7-9.
But it's a beast. Because BGH has got it in his sights. A Golden Imp Gang boss. You know, I haven't seen this card, Golden. This is beautiful.
Whoa.
You what? He's playing around the BGH?
What?
He wants to get as many demons as possible to
exactly,
OTK his opponent,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, makes sense.
Okay. Alright. Amaz recognizes.
I like this play because there's less of a chance for counterplays here.
But you were so vulnerable if you didn't join to the 1-3 taunt.
Mm-hmm. How much of a problem is this?
You could ignore it for a turn, at least.
Well, with the Shredder, you have to at least kill. Because the problem is if your Void Caller goes down, then suddenly you can't ignore it anymore.
Yeah, you can just kill off the Shredder. That's what I meant.
Doomsayer inbound. Nope, not a Doomsayer.
Panda. This is a really hard turn.
Whoa.
What did it steal?
What if that's still bug it is?
I think you still have to make that call. Like, if you want to win the game, the play that wins is probably just exactly what he did.
Yeah, exactly.
Alright, well, that's actually a great card. In this specific circumstance, it doesn't get much better. It's the extra bit of damage he needed to kill that Voidwalker while clearing the board.
In this case, though, I think I'll just go with the Belcher for this turn.
So
you have better board in this case.
Oh, yeah, certainly.
And you get the extra value from the weapon.
So with this play, he's saying, okay, I'm at a high enough health that I just want to be as aggressive as possible.
So in other words, you're saying Caldi's mad.
Yeah.
You pop the Shredder and you get Doomsayer, and then you're shown on TV. Nope.
Oh no.
That is no help.
That's close to a Doomsayer.
Right.
That's
only 4
attack.
Health away. Yeah, I guess one stat line matches. Is that how you evaluate cards now?
By their
stats?
Based
on the stat line. Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay.
Every card is worse than Chobun Yeti.
Right. Yeah, Paladin Shredder doesn't even hold a candle to it. There's no way. Yeah. So that's going to be a second game here.
1-1 now. And now yeah, Paladin at least has gotten a win, even though it was kind of a disappointing matchup against the Warrior.
Yeah, it was an unfortunate outcome, I guess. But I think the fact that he locked the game in the end is still no big issue. He's got Hunter and Warlock left, and Amaz still has his Druid and Warlock. So both players down to Warlock. But Kaldi's got the info of what Amaz's deck contains. So he's got a bit of an edge there if it comes down to future matches. Whereas Amaz is still, you know, in the dark as far as what Hunter and Warlock decks Kaldi brought.
Go ahead.
If you're Amaz here, would you play Druid or Warlock? So you probably don't want to go against a Hunter as a Druid, right?
Nor Zoo. Yeah.
So yeah, Druid is kind of a bad matchup. But then you can always hope that Kali's playing Handlock version of the Warlock instead of a Zoo.
Right. Yeah. Although I'd say Zoo has gained so much in popularity nowadays that it's really tough to justify, maybe.
I think it's entirely possible, to be honest, that both players go into like random.org and just randomize whatever the matchups go up next, right?
Yeah. The way I do it is I put a dice on the table and I flip the table. And depending on what happens with the dice, then I pick a deck.
So you have to go out and buy a table every single time you play Hearthstone?
No, I have a very sturdy
break
one.
You just flip it.
Yeah, I just flip it very, very strongly. And okay. I guess the more uncertain I am, the faster I flip it. So like if it flips in the air, the result is probably even more accurate. Is that not how they choose their decks?
I mean, you can suggest it to Team Archon. Just email them, be like, this
the team house will look like hell in a week. It'll be the worst place to be. It will be like the worst possible team house to live in. So I do suspect both players will move on to Warlock, though, to be honest. I think both Warlocks will face off against each other here.
The Hunter's really good.
Hunter's though. Probably a good play. Yeah, I was going to say maybe Hunter, depending on...
Because some Hunter, yeah. I mean, I wouldn't say all, but there are versions where... deal pretty well with the Zoo decks out there. Just double unleash and explosives. Although explosives doesn't always help.
Yeah, even in mid-range Hunter these days, we're beginning to see a lot of explosive traps because the metagame is really geared towards aggression right now.
Yeah, there's a lot more aggression. Like, the fact that Zoo came back on its own, just that alone is enough to... Because it's not only back, it's also very strong. Imgang Boss brought that card, like that deck, back to life. And now, when you sprinkle in the mid range, like you sprinkle in the mid range late game cards, it's just disgustingly like bad if you don't have the good answers.
Yeah. We're getting word that the next match is going to be Warlock versus Warlock. So, most probably, it's going to be like a Zoo versus Zoo.
Oh, disappointing.
You don't like that matchup?
No. Actually, because Kali the Warlock, maybe it's Handlock instead of a Zoo. Because Henlock is a slightly favorite, right?
Right, right. You know, one card I haven't seen enough of so far is Demon Wrath.
That's true.
Where is it? Where is it, really?
Perhaps it's in Kaldi's deck.
I'm hoping so. I mean, it doesn't kill Flame Imps, but you don't see Flame Imps systematically if you're expecting Face Hunter on ladder at the very least. So, maybe we'll see a Demon Wrath. Ooh. I'm hopeful. Well, maybe not.
No.
Well, one of these hands is better than the other. One of these hands is not the same.
I'll
Which
just say this.
Which one of these hands is better than the other?
I'm flipping my table. Be right back.
Yeah, I can tell. Yeah, let's flip tables here. Is it going to keep everything? I would say so.
Actually, you said that, but now suddenly things...
now suddenly. That is perfect 1-2-3 drop from Amaz. But the same goes with the Kaldi, but
yeah. Kaldi, it's not also... demons. Yeah, Kaldi also has the combo of Knife Sugar and...
An Haunted Keeper and Direwolf Alpha. It's crazy.
Exactly. He's considering whether he wants to just throw out the Haunted Creeper now in order to get value from the Knife Juggler. But if he does that, he's going to get punished by perhaps a Voidwalker.
Yeah. You know, I wonder why people aren't playing an Oigatron in Zoo. I wonder if it couldn't be like a decent addition. You move a little bit away from the mid range. You don't put a high aggression card, but in the Zoo mirror match, how good is an Oigatron? Like, how much work would it do?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, people are cutting Direwolf Alphas and like a lot of two drops from their Demon Lock decks, even. So,
okay,
this might be a reason to not play an Oigatron, right?
Oh, Kelly's got to pick a play. I don't like many of his plays, but he's got a good follow-up with a possible defend of Argus later on. The Knife Juggler popping up the Creeper. I think his next turn is much more exciting than this one.
Although if Amaz goes for Knife Juggler and Void Color, it's not going to be so much more exciting. Because Kaldi is not going to have that good of a play.
Oh, he's going to pop the spiders.
Wow.
That's interesting. He's, so I guess he's setting up for Unleash the Hounds play. Or rather, not Unleash the setting up for the Knife Juggler play next turn.
Yes, yes. Unleash the Hounds.
Kaldi's cheating.
You know, I would quit this game if Zoo got, like, a legit Unleash. Not Implosion. Not Implosion.
To be honest, I don't even think Unleash the Hounds would be good in Zoo, right?
No, I don't.
It would only be good in the mirror because against like Druid and everything.
Druid, yeah, it would do nothing against that. Like against mirror match aggro though, it would come out to like coin flips of who got the Unleash. Unleash the demons. If they ever make Unleash the Imps, I will. Wow, nice hit there.
Yeah.
Any minion needed to be hit by this, so it was like a 75% of wiping the board.
Kaldi is getting slightly punished here. Now that the spiders have been popped, Kaldi can't actually use the Knife Juggler to get any value, and Kaldi's hand is looking pretty bad here.
Yeah, Kaldi needs to get lucky with a Knife Juggler hit, it feels. Do you ever play Void Terror as a body here just for the sake of it, or are you just coining out?
You're just going to trade with 3-1, though. It feels terrible to do so.
Yeah, so maybe you go for Knife Juggler, coin Direwolf, and pray for the 25.
That it would be a winning play if you, if you get that. But in that, the Maz still has the response with Abusive Surgeon and Game Boss. So,
I think it's either Void Terror as a body or the coin play. It's obvious.
It's just bad right now.
Yeah.
Any option Kaldi has just looks really bad.
And Maz is curving really well too next turn with the Imp Gang Boss and the Abusive on 4.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just
he makes the Devoid Terror for his body.
Vanilla 3-3 will just get traded into by the Flame Imp, and Amaz will just have all the answers in the world.
Yeah, he's
putting
so
on even more pressure on his opponent. Like, normally you probably don't, you want to use the Abusive Sergeant to trade up, but I think this is fine because typically Warlock, unless they're running the Demon Wrath card, they don't have a lot of AoE, or any AoE rather. And yet again, it's going to be a pretty bad turn for Kaldi. I mean, the best he could do here is either Lothem, which doesn't deal well with the board. He also has the option of Knife Juggler, Direwolf Alpha, but that does even worse against the board.
Oh my god. All these options are so terrible right now.
I don't see how he's winning this. Like, those matches really come down to who gets the initial tempo swing, and the Maz got it massively so. And I think this is probably a highlight of the liability of, you know, mid-range late-game drops, perhaps, in the mirror match. Like, when you top-deck those mid-game, it's just completely useless.
He is the coin. I'm like, if he can kill off the 3-5 and go for Unleash the Imps with the Knife Juggler, but he doesn't have enough mana.
Yeah, so, wouldn't even have done anything, I think. Well,
he needs to taunt. But if he taunts, he can't play anything else. And there's just lethal on board here.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is... So game 3 goes to Maz. So what do we have here? Kaldi's Warlock and Hunter versus Maz's Druid.
So, can I make a prediction in this specific match? I think the Warlock's going to win this match.
Yeah, so Zoo in specific is going to win this match. Midrange Zoo.
How good would Demon Flame be here? Would it do anything? Would it kill Juggler, Abusive?
You mean Demon Wrath.
Demon Wrath. Yeah, I keep calling Demon Flame as Shadow Flame, Hellfire. I just mix all of them together. You know, Warlock has too much AoE for my taste now. I just get confused between all of them. But yeah, Demon Wrath. Like, I wonder if it wouldn't have been a tipping point in something like this. But I think it's more usable maybe in defensive mid-range decks and possibly Handlock than in Zoo.
Some people used to run Hellfire in Zoo decks.
I remember.
Yeah, mostly for the mirror, and it was back when like Zoo was by far the best deck. At one point in the metagame, pretty much there was Zoo, there was Freeze Mage, and that was it. Those are the only two viable decks.
There was a Flare Hunter for a while too. like with the explosive trap, but kind of mixed in to counter both at the same time with the unleash plays that he used to have. Mm-hmm. That was pretty obscene, but I have to say it was a pretty stale meta game for about a solid 3 weeks straight. Yeah. All right, so the next game. So Amaz is up 2-1 against Kaldi. So Kaldi's going to have to take a win with his Warlock. And Amaz's last deck is Druid. And I think Zoo is fairly favored there. But, like, both decks from Kaldi could win against Druid. In the Conquest format, this may be the weak point of Amaz.
Yeah. But despite the Kaldi's loss, it looked that bad for him. Unless he has a Face Hunter. In that case, it'll be more like 50-50. But if he has Mid-Range Hunter and Zoo deck against a Druid, it's going to be a good matchup for decks.
We have seen Mid-Range Hunter become more popular lately, though. Era got ranked number one on NA recently, and he's held it for about a week with the Mid-Range Hunter. Also, yet another player, the name escapes me, also got ranked number one with the Mid-Range Hunter. In addition, AF Kaibi won the ESL Legendary Series over the weekend, partly due to his Mid-Range Hunter. And there's just so many builds of Mid-Range Hunter these days that it's just really exciting as a deck. Like, how many quick shots do you run? Do you run Web Spinners, which is a card that's getting cut? Do you run Sludge Belchers? Do you run Ragnaros? So many deck decisions and choices that are possibilities.
Yeah, I think the Ragnaros is a really big addition to Mid-Range Hunter that's been popular recently that wasn't really that used prior. It's been played. Like, Dr. Boom was played in Mid-Range Hunter with Savannah High Mains, but topping the curve off with Ragnaros is something that I think it's getting more and more done than it used to be. Like, it existed, but very marginally so. So hopefully we'll see Mid-Range Hunter include it as a bigger late-game option.
Yeah, I love how we're, like, spending so much time talking about Mid-Range Hunter.
But it might just be Face.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, Face Hunter is very exciting, too. I mean, how many quick shots do you put? Wait, I know that.
No. You asked that as a question, but actually, like, a lot of players, they don't put any quick shots in their deck.
That's true. That's true.
Impact, specifically, he was telling me, like, I think all Face Hunters are building the deck wrong. Like, quick shot is just like an arcane shot.
Yep, might as well.
It does slightly more damage, right?
It's a slot for... The thing is, it doesn't curve as well as Arcane Shot most of the time. Like, you rarely draw off of it. Like, you rarely just get an extra card draw and are able to cycle it. You just play it for 3 damage sometime in the mid-game on a minion or something else.
Yeah, that's true, but I feel like doing 3 damage to the face is pretty good often. Just, like, used as a Dark Bomb.
No, you mean as a Cobra Shot?
No. Not as a Cobra Shot. That card doesn't exist as far as I'm concerned.
I've been hoping to see, like, one deck, which one, Mr. Yagut mode, he just brings up, like, explosive shot, and there's somehow, like, a Cobra shot in the Hunter deck. I'm just waiting for that one guy. Like, he plays Face Hunter, he swaps out a quick shot for the Cobra shot, just to prove a point. And then there'll be a post about it.
Cobra shot is 5 mana, right?
Yeah, it's just...
Yeah, I heard in early development, it was actually 4 mana.
And I think and when you look at multi-shot, you're like, maybe that's a better multi-shot for Hunters at that point, though.
It'd be much better.
It'd actually be playable, though, I think.
Yeah.
Definitely.
But do you really want Hunter to get, like, more of these, like, deal damage to face cards?
Do I want Hunter to get, what, anything? Let me think on that. I'll get back to you tomorrow. I think they're really in a good spot with their mid-range. Giving them an extra tool to add to that mid-range deck would make them, like, the kings of mid-range at this point. Maybe even dethroning Druids.
I actually like how currently the Mid-Range Hunter works. It's like kind of like a tempo deck that has like great creatures, and also like it's always threatening just with the hero power.
Yeah. The inevitability of it is the it's basically what carries Hunter as a class whole, like as a whole. That's all it does. Like the hero power putting you on a clock starting on turn 2 effectively. Like, if you're below 15 health and you're not close to a kill, you're probably dead against a Hunter, effectively. So, Amaz is setting up his Druid. I wonder if Kaldi's going to bring Face or mid-range.
Yep,
I know, like, about a week and a half ago, a lot of players thought mid-range Hunter was better than Face, but...
Well, the reason, about, like, a month ago, everyone used Face Hunter, mm-hmm. and that was mostly because... Face Hunter countered Mid-Range Hunter, and no one wanted to bring Mid-Range Hunter to the to tournaments because they would run into so many Face Hunters. But now that Face Hunter has died down a bit because of the Warriors, because of the Freeze Mages that have been popping up, mid-range Hunter is getting its time to shine.
Yeah.
So just the tides of the metagame, I would say.
Yeah, well, that's it's cycles, right? It's just like you have specific decks that go in, go out, and there's a lot of steps to the metagame cycle in Hearthstone, at least. It's, I think, in that regard, more interesting, perhaps, than Magic the Gathering, in the amount of decks that you see just cycle in and out compared to other card games.
We're starting the game right now, and we do indeed see it's going to be mid-range Hunter. So I like this matchup a lot. It's very fun. But, oh, wow, look at Amaz's hand.
Ooh. It's very fun for one player.
Isn't that great?
Yeah, it's very fun for one player.
When you look at a hand like this, you have to say, I mean, somebody here is going to have fun.
Well, if Amaz throws into Wild Growth, though, it's not too bad. In fact, it's pretty good.
Yeah.
The Force of Nature can deal with the Freezing Trap, and once you use that one of it, and Kaldi is going to think, he doesn't have Force of Nature anymore, so he's just going to build them board without killing it. Possibly.
Kaldi's got a pretty good hand, I'd say.
Oh, God. Yeah,
to say the least.
Quite a moving hand. That's not Wild Growth.
Amaz, by seeing that Web Spinner, I think he's going to know that it's mid-range, right? Because that's not being played in face at all.
Yeah. I mean, he isn't playing a Chinese player. Kaldi isn't Chinese. Because we have seen a lot of Chinese players, they put Web Spinner in Face Hunter, and they put Leper Gnome in Midrange Hunter.
I have seen Leper Gnome. Oh, God!
Oh, that's going to be so huge. Wow. Brazilla is actually really good against Druid if you can play it on
the
turn
curve,
7.
Too.
Yeah, it's on curve. It's just like behind... It's the Dr. Boom that Hunters want to play when they don't have Dr. Boom.
So, worse.
Oh, man. This is... Yeah, it's a worse Dr. Boom, granted, but still, it's a Dr. Boom nonetheless.
This board is crazy.
Yeah, I don't think we'll see the mid-range aspect shine here.
Yeah. Would you play Keeper or Polish Shredder? Keeper it is.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Quick shot. Not
Keeper
a play.
Is cool, because if this trap is Freezing Trap...
Or Snake, even.
Oh, no.
Regardless, you'd go face here.
Kaldi misplaced the Piloted Shredder.
Yeah, again, not putting it in the middle.
Masad, you'll never put it not in the middle, right? You won't forsake it like that.
I hope this is a Flame Song Totem. Oh, it's not. So, Amaz is going to try to trigger two traps at a time while it's possible. Perhaps if there's a Snake and a Freezing, but he only sees one trap. Yeah. So, it's going to be... Does he just pass at this point then, yeah?
Oh, wow. I actually just like... Okay, so there's only one trap in this deck, I guess.
Yeah, Freezing is my guess.
I actually... why wouldn't he attack here? Oh,
I don't know.
I guess it's because he has Force of Nature on turn 6, and he wants to trigger that trap with Force of Nature.
Oh, right. Possibly. That makes way too much sense. Why are we asking the question, Monk? That makes just too much sense.
And wow, he's actually going to force a quick shot here.
Yep. Dark Bomb. It reminds me of when Dark Bomb was released, a lot of people said it was horrible because it was a bad Frostbolt. But I was in love with the fact that Warlocks finally got the most OP removal spell they needed for a while. It's like, I've always wanted to use Shadow Bolt, but Dark Bomb finally felt right. I find it very interesting, though, when you look at the fact that so many classes are getting a 2-mana 3-damage spell. Like, initially, Blizzard wanted to go away from... like giving classes non-specific tools, but now they don't seem to mind. Like Frostbolt, Dark Bomb, Quickshot.
I mean, they all do something slightly different.
Yeah.
And it's funny because like every class that has gotten one of those cards, they seem to be using it. Like Quickshot is used, Dark Bomb is used, Frostbolt is used. It actually makes you wonder if every class got like a 3-damage 2-mana spell, how many of them would use it?
I think it's a really sweet spot for removal. I think it's just perfectly made. And Amaz is just going to go on the offensive here. I think he's trying to go for a really aggressive possible follow-up, but... like, if that Gazrael pops the Shredder, it's no big deal. But...
How do you actually kill this Gazrael?
Well, you've got a Force of Nature. You're gonna have to waste it on that. Or, you know, create a few minions into it. BGH could do it.
Yeah, you're just drawing to it. I was going to make it where, you want to draw here, right? Because you want to join to be Game Hunter. But then you can do it next turn anyways because of the Innervate.
So my question to you here, would you attack your own Gazrilla if you could? On a board like this, right? It's a big gamble. It's a huge gamble.
Exactly.
It's a huge gamble. Ooh. Well, still gonna draw, I think.
I think you just force a nature here, actually.
Yeah, you don't really have... Well, do you? I guess you could play the Treant and then innervate out the Ancient of Lore to draw, but...
Well, if you force nature, you can also kill the Knife Juggler. And
yeah,
the,
you can kill everything, yeah.
And the Iron Beak Owl.
What could this be?
Attack Keeper?
It's, well, it's certainly not Direwolf Alpha or Flame Tongue Totem.
Oh, that's why he put it away from the middle then.
Alright, 48 attack, Grazilla. Unfortunately, it's not going to do too much.
And oh, before game glitches and a turn passes.
Yeah, he's going to actually innervate at this Keeper. Yeah.
This is a perfect play. And yeah. Now, Kaldi finds a pretty good follow-up, though. You have to be honest.
Yeah. I think this might just be a turn where he Ragnaroses, though. Because this board, actually, with the current way that it is, it's actually like really good against high main.
What's interesting is, if there was a BGH, he would have probably seen it, you know, last turn.
Oh, certainly.
Or Gazrilla, so now he's not afraid at all of it dying to BGH, unless, like, there's a perfect outcome.
Oh, man.
Goodness.
Come on, Amaz. You can do it.
You know, we said he cut out Ragnaros, the RNG started to stabilize, but it might not have done, so, and now...
Oh, my God.
Do I believe?
I believe in Neg. Oh. It's face.
It's still pretty good, though.
Exactly.
It's still really dangerous. Masan's like, oh, it hits face. Wait, no, that's still pretty solid, but this is still anyone's game, depending on Rag RNG.
Do you just unleash here? And if you do unleash, do you go for face, or do you kill the Zombie Chow?
I face all the time.
I'll go. Whoa.
Okay, Zombie Chow.
Okay.
I kind of like...
Rag hit...
This actually plays around the combo, although there is no combo for sure.
Okay.
What's interesting though is that if he'd gone phase like we mentioned, swipe would have been a problem. But now, like, if it hits phase, it's amazing because you're almost putting your opponent dead with your hero power. And if it hits the rag, then you're still far ahead, so you're gonna win eventually. So I think that play was more stable because if it hit the Zombie Chow, it overkilled by a lot and wasted your turn.
Certainly,
that was a lot better.
This is a really tough turn for Amaz, by the way.
Well, I mean, you could swipe the high main. No, I mean, swipe high main hero power, the high main down, or treant it down, then swipe. I don't know. Like, you have to kill the 2/2s, right? So you have to swipe hero power face and hope that rag kills the rag.
Oh, my.
That's the best he can do, I think, at this point.
Yeah.
That's the best you can hope for.
It's a quarter chance. Whoa. Oh, yeah, it's...
Yeah, definitely. Alright, what is the rag? Oh!
Wow!
Huge. Amaz is riding huge once again.
Yeah, and now he's got the healing, so he may be able to stabilize out of this position. Whoa.
He actually will. Yeah, he might. He probably will, actually.
He definitely will, I think, at this point. I king the juggler with the... unless the egg pops. How bad would that be? How bad? If you play Druid of the Claw, it's not a problem, though. I think Druid of the Claw is better than Ancient of Lore. But then you have to kill... the beast. Well, maybe not.
You actually...
Maybe you heal yourself instead. I think it's more health... And you're less vulnerable to follow up. So I'm just curious though if the egg will pop.
Top deck.
Quick shot into kill command.
Oh!
6 damage. How does he find lethal here? A Leok would help.
Oh my god.
Leok, yeah. Huffer, Misha. Anything goes. Huffer's the best.
Of course it's Huffer.
What's this card you called the Leok?
So he's one damage off lethal.
Wow. What is Leok and how do I hound? Oh goodness. Alright.
I thought the animal companion was 3 mana cooldown Huffer.
Savage Roar is lethal, though, right? With Drew the Claw. Uh-oh, that's not really lethal.
And I think that's actually...
Game.
That's game.
Yeah, that's it. That's good game. No matter what, the hero power from Kaldi, even with the armor up, is going to end the game. So Maz is going to have to bow down to Hunter.
Unless...
Like all of us. No, there's no... Wait.
That's Ragnaros. It's fair.
Oh, nah. Wow. It's the center lane, but not in the right position. Yep. That was... I thought it was going to hover over the Nerubian and go full face. But it did not. All right, well, Kaldi is going to be equalizing the series 2-2 here with mid-range Hunter versus Druid. Not really a huge surprise. I'd say mid-range Hunter is one of the matchups that is known to be able to contest. But that Gazrilla really forced the Maz to go all in on removal because there was no other threat for Kaldi to put out at that point.
Yeah, I have to say Kaldi probably is he's feeling good about himself right now because the final matchup will be Zoo against mid-range Druid. And it's usually generally a favorable matchup for Zoo, right?
Yep.
Heavily,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah. I always talk about the dynamic between Zoo, Mechmage, and Druid, because I feel even though Zoo is really good against Druid, I feel like Mechmage is better against Druid. And because Zoo has a favorable matchup against Mechmage, I feel like because Zoo has come onto the scene, Mechmage has gone down in usage, and therefore Druid has actually benefited from Zoo getting into the scene, or from Zoo getting better.
Even though they have a bad matchup against it, they're still better off over the against the field.
Yeah,
than
exactly. And not only that, because Zoo has gotten popular, Freeze Mage has also gotten popular in response, and that's also a good matchup for Druid. And also Tempo Mage, it's gotten much worse because of Zoo, and that used to be a really good matchup for Tempo Mage versus Druid as well. So yeah, I would say Zoo actually helped Druid.
So, what's going to be the downfall of it then? Kalento Priest?
Kalento Priest.
That's all you need to play. Just play Kalento Priest. You steal their 4/6s and their 4/5s, and you should be good. I think Paladin, maybe once all the dragons are released. I mean, this is going to be the big week, honestly. Like, this date that we're getting tomorrow with Blackrock Mountain coming out is going to be a huge day as far as, you know, brewing decks comes out, because the entire packet of dragons will have come out. So give it another 3 weeks and we start seeing exactly where the metagame will, you know, head for a little while.
Is it going to be tomorrow or the day after?
It's tomorrow for the release. Yeah, it's actually at the same time of the Amaz Team Brawl, but I don't know if they'll get to play with the cards that are new. I don't think so, but still. Hype!
Yeah, definitely a lot of hype for all those final cards, and definitely hype for all the dragon decks that we'll almost certainly be likely to see.
Yeah, I've got a theory crafted rogue dragon deck at the moment, without the latest additions, and it's using 2 Skulkers. It's doing pretty fine. Like, you play Cro-Magus and Ysera as late game legendaries, but it's just not it feels like it's missing something, and hopefully I'll be able to polish it tomorrow.
Okay,
this
so
hand, by the way.
Final game. Yeah, this hand is the perfect
hand.
Oh
my god.
If you ignore Dr.
Are you kidding me?
Well, maybe Kaldi's got a perfect hand as well. It's just hidden for now.
You don't want the perfect hand, though.
Well,
against this, because if you have a perfect hand, you're going to die. You're
oh
going
no,
down.
He has the flame imp.
Oh no.
He's got everything. This is perfect. See? It's perfect versus perfect.
Oh man, even a Drew to the Claw follow up.
Oh dear.
I just puked in my mouth. Thank you.
Well, you know what? This, even though Amaz does have the turn 3 Keeper of the Grove, this Flame Imp will be able to get a lot of damage in.
Just 6, I think. No, actually, it could be 9, I guess. Yeah,
if I give you a 1 mana spell that hits for 6, would you play it? That's all I'm telling you.
Yes,
that's
I will.
That's it. I think I would.
And also, actually, this.
Do you just Dr. Boom here?
Isn't that great?
Do you just innervate Dr. Boom?
Oh, it's also certainly possible.
I kind of like that better than Drew the Claw.
Yeah.
If you do, though, that gives your Imp Gang boss more targets.
Possibly.
But but if you just play Drew the Claw, you are vulnerable to something like a Power Overwhelming.
Mm-hmm.
So, judging from the hands, I think Drew the Claw might have been better. But just overall, I feel Maz's play of Dr. Boom was better.
Yeah, going in blind, you probably play Dr. Boom here most of the time.
Yeah.
even with the egg here.
Oh, wow. If the egg gets popped, this could be like the two death rattles and the Imp Gang boss adding a lot of value to the Boom Bot's death rattles. I never thought I'd say that.
Wait a minute.
Oh, that was strange.
That was very strange.
He doesn't want to lose the Flame Imp, I'm guessing.
Yeah, that makes sense. Oh, one damage to Haunted Creeper.
Yeah. So do you so just this, punch face as hard as you can?
This Dr. Boom might have gotten his degree from, like... I don't want to say any country, because...
I was going to say, Monk, you're going in very murky, murky waters here. Yeah. I would not engage. Like, you need to abort this mission right
abort,
now.
Abort.
This is not a thing to do.
So this is looking very tough for Kaldi. After all, that dead end was too good, I think.
Oh, man. Yeah, just all these cards are pretty much useless at this point.
Yeah, you're dead next turn, like, in your mind at this point. Like, you wanted Power of Whelming, you wanted... I don't even know what else you wanted. Like, at this point, it's so hopeless. Do you just go face, or do you go for Emperor? I think face
I think
is...
I'll just... Taunt up. Wait, I mean,
I like face.
Yeah, I'll just go face.
Yeah, he's like two off lead. He's one off lead left. Yeah,
so
I mean, he's got force of nature, so he can go through everything. No life tap, no flame imp. Makes everything worse, actually. For Kaldi, he's got one dead card in his hand on top of everything else.
In his Bane of Doom, he didn't get it.
So you silence your egg, and then you concede.
Oh man, this is so unfortunate for Kaldi.
It's a terrible, like, he had a pretty good start, I'd say, though, but it didn't have good follow-ups. I guess Amaz's was better. Like, Battle of the Titans. Those hands.
It's one of those games where you, it doesn't almost matter what you do or what you open with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it does happen. That's what Druid sometimes makes you feel like. You know, when they get ahead with the Innervate Wild Growth early on, and I think the Keeper of the Grove was also something we have to mention, because that Wild Growth... and that Innervate, you know, on their own, they're nice. But without mm-hmm. Keeper, you don't have the support to give you the early game removal of the Knife Juggler. That would have been pretty bad if that wasn't there.
Yeah, and that's massive, because Keeper usually kills off three minions over the course of 3 to 4 turns. And that's really downfall of Zoo.
Yep.
Yeah. Really need that board's establishment, like, and the damage.
I just have to feel... I just feel that, like, Kaldi must be kicking himself right now, because he was second in the league, and now he drops down a lot. His record now is 5-4, which means that it's very likely that he won't be able to get a playoff spot, whereas before, he was in a really good position.
Yeah, he's going to be right now behind Kalento at the moment, which is already climbing up as a result of this loss from Kaldi. So Kalento is now, I think, third at the moment behind Hyped, and Trump... has the potential to also go up, but I think no matter what, he'll either tie with Kalento or... it'll depend on the tiebreaker, but Trump might overtake Kalento if he ends up winning his game.
Not only that, but Kaldi, you saw he kind of ran out of time in the first game. And if he didn't, he could have very easily won this match. So he might just be kicking himself for that.
Yeah, the Paladin turn where he couldn't get the trade on the Emperor Thorsen with the Aldor Peacekeeper. That was a horrible turn for him. Well, that's going to be the second match of the day. A really intense match again, you know, going 3-2. I've seen a lot of sweeps recently. I guess with the, not removal, but the slight, like, lower representation of Face Hunter, we see less, you know, hyper-fast matches. But it still might happen. So next up is going to be Hyped versus Life Coach. Both of those players are currently in the top three. Hyped is second, Life Coach is first. So this is a really important match for Hyped, because he wants to make sure he can secure that second place, I think, because Trump and Kalento might be able to threaten him, at least Trump, if he does win the match. So it's all going to come down to that one. Life Coach is safely sitting on his first spot. So we'll be right back with that match after the break. 7 minutes. Don't go.